Hello everyone and welcome back to Power Electronics Lectures. Today I'm going to talk about the isolated power converters. The previous time we talked about the non-isolated DC to DC converters. We had an introduction to the buck converter, boost converter, buck boost converter and the choke converter. And also we said there are many different topologies such as the SEPEC converter, but in many applications the output voltage should be electrically isolated from the input side, either for protection, for safety, and for eliminating the leakage current or the common mode voltage. Also, sometimes a multi-output converter is required in some applications. If you look at the isolated DC to DC converters or isolated converters in general, you'll find that the high or medium frequency transformers, which are not the line transformers, provide a solution to replace the line frequency transformers in some applications. The high frequency transformers are much smaller than the line transformers, and also they significantly shrink the converter volume and the footprint for the whole power converter. This is a typical configuration for power converters. If you remember last time, we used a line transformer on this side to make isolation from the input side of the power line. But here we can use only a rectifier circuit. Within this converter, we have high frequency transformers. And these high frequency transformers, it's not the 50 Hz or 60 Hz transformers. Can be within 1 kHz, for example, to normally 20 kHz. But if you want to go higher than this frequency, we need specific type of materials and we need special design for these transformers. And this is a typical system. Here we have a feedback from the voltage output. We have a reference signal. We can use a controller, simple controller. And also we can, if you want to take a feedback from the input current, we need to convert the voltage signal that we have from voltage to a current to give a reference signal as a current signal, and then after that we supply our switches in this converter. In this kind of converters, we are trying to lock the voltage values and the current values to make sure that our converter is operating properly. How can we do this? Usually we have a carrier frequency, and this carrier frequency can be something like triangular wave or a sawtooth wave, and we compare this triangular wave or a sawtooth wave with the reference value. Or if you want to operate this converter in an open loop system, we just compare it with a normal line, just a compare value to generate the pulse width modulated signals. If we increase the value of this line, so we expect that we have a wider pulse. If we decrease the value for this line, we expect that we have a smaller pulse. And this is the basic for any DC-DC converter or any converter in general. Let's focus now on these transformers, the high frequency transformers, and see, come back to the basics of these transformers and see what kind of materials and what are the parameters that are necessary to memorize or to take into consideration when we design or when we take any transformer into consideration. Okay, let's consider this toroid core transformer. If you go for some definitions, and from these definitions, we make some relations between the terms to make the terminologies behind this transformer much easier or easier than what we expect. Here we have the primary coil for this transformer, and here we have the secondary coil for this transformer. We know that if the current is going inside the dot, and this dot is actually just define the way how we coil or the way how we turn the coil around this core. So if the current is going inside the dot in the primary winding, so we expect that the flux is going in this direction, right? So this is what we learned in the past. So here, if the current is going inside the dot for this primary, and the current on the secondary also coming inside the dot, so these two fluxes will be moving in the same direction. Now, if the secondary is connected, for example, to a load, similar to the case of the transformer or the ideal transformer, so we expect that we taking current from the output, and if we have current coming inside the dot, so on the output the current will be going outside the dot. So here again, if we have current coming inside the dot for the primary and another current like a voltage source and this giving the dot on the secondary, then these two fluxes moving in the same direction. Okay, so they add to each other. Now, if the case similar to what we have in the transformer, so we expect that we have a load here and you are taking current from here. So we expect that this flux, which is building from the primary coil, should be captured from the secondary coil. And this is what's happening when we have an ideal transformer, for example. We have a primary current, the current going inside the dot, and from the secondary, the current going outside of the dot. So this is the case for the transformer. If both currents coming inside the dot from the primary and the secondary, so we expect that these two currents add to each other. So they are moving in the same direction. Now let's go and make some definitions from this transformer. If we say that if we give definition B, we know B is equivalent to what? The magnetic flux density. And this is usually measured by Tesla. And Tesla is what we call is Weber per meter square. But let's wait for this one to define the total magnetic flux flowing inside the core. If you consider phi, so phi is what? Is the total magnetic flux. And this total magnetic flux is measured by either Tesla meter square, volt second, or Weber. So here we have a relation between the magnetic flux density and the total magnetic flux, which is what? This is Tesla meter square, and this should be what? Weber per meter squared. So if you know the cross-sectional area for this core, so definitely we must have some relation between the magnetic flux density and the total magnetic flux. Now, if you go to the magnetic field, so this is the magnetic field intensity or magnetic field, which is ampere per meter. So here, for the magnetic flux density, this is related with the total magnetic flux with the area meter square, and this magnetic field is related with the current and the length, let's say, of the core. So these three definitions are very important. From these three definitions, we can define the relation between the magnetic flux, the magnetic field, and the current. And here we'll find that we have a direct relation between the magnetic flux and the voltage. So we can say that B is directly linked to the terminal voltage of the magnetic device. And this is according to Faraday's law. If you look at the magnetic field, you'll find that H is directly linked with the terminal or linked to the terminal current of the magnetic device according to Ampere's law. Now here we have a hidden link between the magnetic field and the magnetic flux density, which is permeability of the material or the core material. So we can say that B and H are directly linked by the permeability characteristics of the magnetic material used in the core. And we can say that B is equal to the permeability times the magnetic field. So this is the relation between the magnetic flux density and the magnetic field. Usually in high or medium frequency transformers that are used in isolated power converters, the relation between the magnetic flux density And the magnetic field intensity is very important. Now, when we understand the relationship between the magnetic flux density and the magnetic field, this will help us in defining the limits of the current, the inductance, and the frequency that can operate the switching devices. Also, it helps us in understanding the limits of the maximum power transfer between the two terminals of the transformer. Also, if you think about the power transfer, it's also related to the permeability characteristics of the magnetic material used in the core. Let's have a look at the relationship between the magnetic flux density and the magnetic field. In the free space, you will find that the permeability of the free space is very small, and it's equivalent to 4 pi times 10 to the power minus 7, and it's measured by Henry per meter. If we have a core material, like for a specific magnetic core material, the BH curve is nonlinear and it has saturation and hysteresis, which means that the maximum magnetic flux density has limit and this is saturated at certain point. And this, of course, depends on the material that is used to build the core. And also, if you think about it here, the values for the relation between the B and H, the permeability for this core, it's different when we going up the curve and coming down the curve like this. You'll find that this effect of the hysteresis and the B maximum, the saturation value for this will be changed if we try to add an air gap within our core. But anyways, the maximum flux density will not be changed, but the behavior of the curve will be changed. So it can be something like this. So we can reach higher magnetic fields by applying, like by reaching the maximum flux density. We'll look at this behavior in the coming lectures. But for now, it's good to know that we have a specific relation between the magnetic flux density and the magnetic field in the core. The permeability of the magnetic materials can be changed from 1000 Henry per meter to values such as 150,000 Henry per meter, and the maximum flux density can be reached from 0.4 to 2 Tesla. We'll see now some of the commonly used materials for high frequency transformer and see what are the characteristics for each one of these materials. So here, for example, if you look at the ferrites, you'll find that the permeability for this material is equal to 2200 Henry per meter. And the maximum flux for this material can be around 0.5 Tesla. And also, if you look at the power density, you'll find that the power density for the ferrite is equal to 288 milliwatts per centimeters cube. The good point here, or the important point here, we need to look at the specific magnetic flux density at certain frequency. For example, we'll see if we increase the frequency for this transformer, how much the magnetic flux density can be reached. For example, for the ferrite core, you'll find that at 0.2 Tesla, we can operate 50 kilohertz frequency. So you can see now when we increase the frequency, the magnetic flux density became smaller. But the question is, can we reach higher frequency and keeping the magnetic flux density to 0.2 Tesla, for example, or not? So this is a good question. Now, if you look at the nanocrystalline materials, you'll find that the permeability is very high for these kind of materials. But of course, this is proportional to the cost of such materials. So you find that the mu for the nanocrystallines is equivalent to almost 15,000 Henry per meters, and the maximum flux can be reached to 1.2 Tesla. And for the power density, it's like similar to the ferrites. So this will be 312 milliwatts per centimeter cube. This is also milliwatts per centimeter cube. And here again, for 0.2 Tesla, this nanocrystalline materials can operate at 100 kilohertz, which is really nice. So for nanocrystallines, we can operate at higher switching frequencies. We'll see what is the advantage of utilizing higher switching frequencies for such materials, or maybe if we can operate at lower frequencies but increase the maximum flux density, this means we can transfer more power from the primary to the secondary. Amorphous material also, it will be similar to the nanocrystallines. The permeability of this material is equivalent to 10,000 to 150,000, which is too high, but this can operate at 1.56 Tesla, and the power density is equivalent to 366 milliwatts per the cubic centimeter, and at 0.2 Tesla, this frequency is equivalent to 25 kilohertz. Now, if you look at the iron alloys, you'll find that this is 5,000 to 10,000, and this is 2 Tesla, and the power density for this is equivalent to 5.7 milliwatts per cubic centimeter, which is very small compared to like ferrites, nanocrystallines, or amorphous. So this can be maybe disadvantage in this. And for 1.5 Tesla, this can be operated at 50 Hertz only. Powdered ion from 50 to 500. So we have a small permeability for this material. And the Tesla is equal to, or the maximum flux is from 0.6 to 1.3 Tesla. The power density for this one is very high. This is 1,032 milliwatts per the cubic centimeter. And we can operate this kind of material at 10 kilohertz. The flux density here, it will be how much? 0.2 Tesla. So this is just a general overview and comparison between some of the materials that can be used in manufacturing the cores for the transformers in general. And also, it's very good to know that some of the cores can operate at high switching frequency or at high frequency, and also they can allow a high maximum flux density, which means we can transfer more power or more flux within the core. So the input voltage and the current can be transferred to the secondary without saturating the core. And that is a really nice feature, but sometimes we need to look at the cost of these materials and these cores, which is very important as well. Coming back to our transformer, but now we remove the secondary winding from this transformer and we'll study this transformer as an inductance only. How can we obtain the value of the inductor of such coil? From Ampere's law, we said that the integration of the magnetic field is the DLC is equivalent to the integration around the surface. This is around the LC. We'll see now what is LC. So this is the length of this core, and this is around the surface, JDS. J is the current density that crosses the surface that the magnetic field makes. So here, when you look at the magnetic field, you'll find that here we have a surface, that this magnetic field makes a surface, which is this surface. So if you look at the current here, you'll find that this current crosses this surface many times, depends on how many turns we have in this coil. So J is the current density that crosses the surface that the magnetic field makes. So this equation can be translated to how much? The HC, the magnetic field. This core has a permeability of mu C, the permeability of the core. Here the length for the core, and here we have the cross-sectional area, AC. So this is the current. So HC is equal to HC times LC will be equal to how much? N number of turns times the current. And from this equation, we can say that HC is equal to N times I, the current, over the LC. Now we know that BC is equal to the permeability times the magnetic field HC for the core. So we can use this equation here and this equation to find that BC is equal to how much? mu c times n I over L c. And do you remember when I said that b can be measured, the unit for b is Tesla, and the unit for the total magnetic flux is how much? We said Tesla meter. So we can say that we can memorize from this definition, these units, that phi is equal to BC times the area, the cross-sectional area, AC, this area. So this is the definition for phi. So from here we can say that phi is equal to BC, this value, times cross-sectional area. So phi is equal to mu C times NAC times the current over LC. And this is the magnetic, the total magnetic flux that's flowing inside this core. If we try to define the magnetic flux linkage, so this is by definition is equal to the number of turns times the magnetic flux, the total magnetic flux. And this flux linkage is usually is defined by how many times the total flux cut the surface or travel through the surface that's made by the coil. So if we have this area, 1, 2, 3, depends on how many coils, how many turns we have. So the flux linkage is equal to the number of turns times the total flux that is traveling through this area or these turns. So subsequently, we can say that the flux linkage, lambda, is directly linked with the inductance. So we can say that L is equal to lambda over I, and we know that the voltage is equal to how much? L di by dt, and we already now memorize this equation from previous lectures, so we can replace this I with lambda over L, so we can say that V is equal to how much? L d lambda over L. L is constant going here, L go with L. So finally, we can say that V is how much? D lambda over dt. So this is the voltage. This equation just aside, we'll use it in the future. But now, let's just use this equation, which is L is equal to lambda over I. And now we know that lambda is N times phi. We defined phi already, which is mu C N times AC times I over LC. So we can just replace this one here and replace this one here. So we can say that lambda is equal to mu C N squared ACI over LC. And then we divide by I. So I will go with I. So at the end, we will have this equation for the inductance. So L is equal to mu C times N squared cross-sectional area for the core divided by the length of the core. And this is the inductance for this coil if we turn this coil around this core. Finally, we got this value, and you'll see that now we have this inductance depends on many factors. Number one, you'll find that this inductance depends on number of turns. So if we increase the number of turns, so definitely the inductance will be increased. And also the core dimensions, AC and LC. The material, the permeability of the material. So all of these factors affect the inductance for this inductor. However, for example, if you look at the mu C, usually mu C is not constant and it depends on the magnetic field and many other factors. For example, sometimes the temperature plays a role in the value of the permeability of the magnetic material and many other factors. Now let's go and try to understand or study the inductance with an air gap. If we add air gap here, for example, how can we calculate the inductance for this kind of inductors? The air gap is proposed to present almost fixed inductance and to allow the BH curve to provide a wide range of operations so we can unlock the saturation limit for the core or for the BH curve. And if you remember, we said that the inductance without this air gap, it's not fixed. because it depends on many factors like the temperature and the permeability of the material itself. So this is a variable. But if we add an air gap like this one, we'll see now how we'll make some analysis and see if this will this make any change or not. So now from Ampere's law, we said that HC times LC is equal to N times I. But because we have an air gap here, we can say that HCLC plus H for the gap times the length for the gap. So this plus this is equal to a number of turns times the current that's flowing in these turns. Now we expect that the length of this air gap is very small, and the total flux that's traveling through this core will be the same as the total flux that's coming within the gap. It will be the same, almost the same flux density, but the total flux here, the area of this cross-sectional area here for the gap will be a little bit larger than the cross-sectional area of the core. But if you look at this one, you can say that the total flux here that's traveling through the core, BC times AC, must be equal to the total flux within the air gap, which is very small. Of course, the air gap will not be large, otherwise the permeability in the air in the free space is much smaller than the core, and the magnetic flux will be like will be lost. So again, we can say that BC for the core is equal to the permeability of the core times the magnetic field, and BG is equal to the permeability of the free space, which is mu naught times HG. And from these two equations, we can simplify them and say that HC is equal to BC over mu C, and HG is equal to BG over mu naught. From this equation, we can say that BG is equal to BCAC over AG, and I'll call this equation number 1, for example. And from these two equations, I'll call them equation number 2. So from 1 and 2, we can say that HG is equal to how much? We just place this BG, so you'll find that this is BCAC over mu naught times AG. And I'll call this equation number 3. And coming back here, I'll say this equation number star, for example. Now look at this equation 3, 2, and 1, and substitute them in equation number star and see the following. We can say that BC times LC over mu C plus BCAC times LG over mu naught AG is equal to N times I. Divide all these by AC, so we can say this is AC. This AC will go from here, and here we have mu C AC. Now take a BC out, so this will be BC times LC over mu C times AC plus LG, the air gap length, over mu naught times AG. All this will be equal to NI over AC, the cross-sectional area AC. And from this we can find the magnetic flux density in the core, which is BC, which is equal to how much? NI over AC, all of this divided by LC over mu C AC plus LG over mu naught AG. And this is the magnetic flux density in the core. Now let's go and find phi, the total magnetic flux, which is related to the cross-sectional area. So we can say that phi is equal to BC times AC. So AC will go with AC, so phi is equal to how much? NI over LC over mu C AC plus LG over mu naught AG. And again, if you remember, we said that phi is equal to how much? Lambda over n, or lambda is equal to phi times n. And also we said that L is equal to lambda over I. So simply we can say that L is equal to how much? Phi times N over I. We can use this relation and substitute by phi. So we can say that L is equal to how much? N squared. I will go with I, and N will multiply by another N. It will be N squared over L C over mu C A C plus L G over mu naught A G. And this is the inductance for this coil that is turned, that is winded around this core with an air gap. Now let's think about this value here. If you remember, we said that mu C is much greater than mu naught. Since mu C is much greater than mu naught, so the inductance of the core with an air gap can be simplified to be as follows. So we can say that this value, which is much smaller than this value, can be neglected. And we can simplify this inductance to be N squared over LG over mu naught times AG. Look at this inductance. Make just some simplification here. Finally, L is equal to mu naught will go up. The air gap, cross-sectional area will go up, and N squared over LG. And this is the value of the inductor with an air gap. As a result, you will find that the inductance is constant and only dependent on the dimensions of the air gap and the number of turns. So this is constant for the air space, for the free space. AG, the cross-sectional area for the air gap. LG is the length of the air gap, nothing to do with the core. And here we have the number of turns. So only these things that can dominate the value of the inductance. The advantages of adding the air gap are the following. Number one, the air gap makes the inductance less dependent on the core permeability, and also the air gap increases the saturation current, and hence we have a higher power transfer. The disadvantage of adding the air gap is that it decreases the inductance. However, the inductance can be increased by increasing the number of turns, increasing the area of the cross-section of the core, or by decreasing the gap length. But everything here is compromised. So if we increase the number of turns, it will be difficult for us to increase the cross-sectional area of the core, and hence increase the cross-sectional area of the air gap. I hope that you enjoyed this lecture. If you have any questions, let me know, and I'll see you next time.